We do live in a culture today, which in many ways is hostile to masculinity. And many men are afraid to acquire more because they're afraid that they're acquiring toxic masculinity.
Right.
And they'll be punished for it. But once the father's taken out, then the mother is often taken out.
Right.
And so the whole family disintegrates and the functionaries of the state become the de facto parents. So if the woman adopts the competitive attitude, then she's going to envy the man's power. We hear about equality, but I don't think it's equality. I think it's a lust for power.
Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. My guest today on this episode of the Dr. J Show is Dr. Stephen Baskerville. Dr. Baskerville has been a guest of the Ruth Institute on numerous occasions, generally talking about his work in political science. But today, he has something a little different for us. That's his foray into the self-help genre. And I think you're going to find this a very interesting and helpful conversation, particularly the gentlemen in the room are going to find this very helpful. Dr. Steve Baskerville, thank you so much for being my guest today. How are you doing?
Thank you. It's my pleasure. It's good to be here.
Yeah, that's great. Well, so tell people a little bit about why you decided to do a self-help book, a gentleman's guide. I mean, look at this retro picture on the cover here. It's great. What's your thought process in going into a book like this?
Well, I'd written books, kind of semi-scholarly books on the family, men, relations between men and women. And I don't think they're esoteric, but they're kind of, objective social science, telling people the way things are and exposing some of the problems with the family and with men and with male-female relationships. But having done this, several of these such books, I decided that I try to write something with a little bit of impact, because even though I sometimes make recommendations in my previous books, I don't really give people an agenda, something they can do to make a difference. So I thought I would go to the other extreme in a sense and write a book that is that tells people what you can do in the course of your own private life, your own daily life, to make a difference in some of these matters. And of course, it's just one man in this case at a time. But the idea was to do something which would give people a feeling that they could do something to at one time prove at the same time improve their private personal life, but also make a contribution to the society and some of these larger issues that we're dealing with today.
So there are a number of very interesting things about this, you writing this particular book. I'm just going to say to all of the readers, listeners, followers here, if you're not familiar with Dr. Baskerville's early work, he is, in my opinion, the most important theorist on the problems associated with no-fault divorce, the social problems as well as the personal problems. And that's why we've been in touch over the years about these matters. And I think it's kind of interesting that you're writing a book with Sophia Institute Press, which is a very Catholic press. You're not Catholic. How did that come about that you ended up writing this particular book with that particular publisher?
Well, my previous book, my more serious book, if you like, was also with a Catholic publisher. It deals with some of the issues. I don't presuppose, it's not a Christian book as such.
Right.
I don't presuppose that the reader is a Christian, even. I presuppose the reader is a man, a young man, most likely, who at least is open to the possibility of improving himself and his life, but also including things like religious faith. And I try to show why religious faith is historically and substantively an important part. Of being a gentleman, of being a man, and I hope that it's written for readers who at least will listen with an open mind as to why they should consider Christian faith as an important part of being a well-rounded man, of being a gentleman, even if that's something that hasn't been part of their life up till now.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that's very interesting and very important. And just specifically on the divorce issue, it has always, you and I have had numerous conversations over the years about the role of the churches in divorce, and, why don't the churches do more, and, so on and so forth. And your personal religious journey, if I'm not mistaken, you started as an Anglican, and I'm not sure where you are these days. Do you mind sharing that with us?
Well, actually, I was raised more or less as an atheist.
You were what?
I was more or less raised as an atheist.
Oh, I see.
I was raised without any religious faith at all. And I, later in life, when I became a Christian, I adopted the faith of my ancestors, which was, yes, the Anglican Church.
I see.
And it's broad enough to go from, you know, Protestant to semi-Catholic. And that's why, in a sense, I write the book for someone who might have been of my disposition in his teens or his 20s or 30s, of not necessarily being a dogmatic atheist, hardcore opponent of religion, but someone who's kind of indifferent to it and hadn't really thought about it much one way or the other. And so I try to appeal to and show men, young men especially, why religious faith is part of the is part of that part of his education, part of being a well-rounded man.
Yes. So let's go to the kind of what the core question is: what is a gentleman? You know, when you say a gentleman's guide, you presuppose that people want to become gentlemen. What's your definition of a gentleman, Steve?
That's a good question. I don't really give anywhere in the book, 25 words or less definition of a gentleman. I do describe how it's been treated over the centuries, because it's been a question over the centuries. This is not a new genre, by the way. We call this a self-help book, but older men have been writing books like this at least since the Renaissance, and really since the Middle Ages, showing younger men and men from lower classes, so working their way up through the social ranks, how to be a gentleman. And it's something that has been defined and redefined over the centuries in various ways. And there's always a tension in it. There's the concept of a gentleman as a member of a defined social class, for example, the gentry, the kind of lower nobility, untitled nobility of England who ran the English shires for centuries. So there's that identification. But all through the history of the gentleman, there's always been critics who have wanted to infuse the definition with more ethical, including religious concepts, definitions. If you look at the novels of the 19th century, Jane Austen, Charles Dickens, Thackeray, a big theme in those is how the gentlemen of the time, those members of the gentry class who are running the country, aren't behaving according to the ideals that they profess. There's a need for a definition that involves ethics, that involves a gentleman acting as a gentleman should,
yes,
not just having the wealth and the status and the power,
right,
and the accoutrements of being a gentleman. And if you go back further, I treat the subject of among the greatest critics in the redefinition or the molding of the definition of the gentleman over the centuries were the Puritans, who preached to the Parliament in the 16th and 17th centuries, and to the local government officials, and with a similar theme. You may think you're gentlemen, you may have lands and hounds and hawks and wealth and power, but if you don't answer to God, if you don't do what God says, you're not really, you're not a man of honor.
Right.
So the Puritans and others, mm-hmm, other churchmen, sought to infuse this. And of course, it was the Puritans who brought the ideal to America as well.
So you used a little bit different phrase that I want to pull out and tease out a little bit. And that's the man of honor, the man of honor. And as you were talking, and from time to time, actually, during your book, I thought of the concept of chivalry from the Middle Ages. Okay. And so it seems like, does the gentleman and the chivalrous person, the chivalrous man, are those ideals connected to each other? If so, how? Are they different social classes? Or does man of honor cover all of those classes? Talk
that's
to us about
question.
That.
Yeah, that's a good question. Yes, the short answer is yes, it certainly does come out of the medieval concept of the knight and the chivalrous behavior. As that was modified quite drastically, with the loss of knighthood, with the loss of the feudal system,
right?
It was kind of, the whole ideal was kind of tamed, but it continued with with the Renaissance, the idea of the gentleman, the self-help books, the most famous of which, of course, Castiglione is the courtier, and of course Machiavelli's the prince,
right?
They're not exactly typical, but they're extreme examples of the genre that exploded during the Renaissance, and as I mentioned, also during the Reformation. So the gentleman, yes, is a tamed, domesticated version, if you like, of the knight, the man who rules, not necessarily a military order being primary, but certainly part of the ruling class.
So the subtitle of your book is A Gentleman's Guide to Manners, Sex, and Ruling the World. That's pretty audacious, Steve. Why don't you give people a little bit of an idea of the kind of tips and advice that they might find in this book?
Okay, well, some of it is I consulted my predecessors over the centuries, going back to the 17th and 16th centuries, advice books for gentlemen coming out of England, going back to in the English-speaking world, Thomas Eliot's Book of the Governor. And that book, as the title indicates, was written for statesmen, for the rulers. And this is one of the themes of the book, is that a gentleman and that men who have attained the status of gentlemen or aspire to are the natural rulers of society. When I say rulers, it doesn't mean necessarily politicians running the country, telling other people what to do, but ruling that piece of turf that God has given you in the course of your daily life, even if it's just your dormitory room. But that's part of it, because after all, men, unlike women in many cases, cannot turn to welfare or charity or the state to help them out in distress. Men have to have to rely on themselves, at least for themselves, and then from there for the other domains, the other parts of the earth which they might rule, even if that's just their family or their neighborhood or their associates, their place of work. So a man always has to be ready to be a ruler, even if the domain that he rules is very, very modest. But a lot of the book is the advice that you will find in a lot of the the genre over the centuries. One of the things that's different, though, I found with the book, is that traditionally the definition of manhood and the definition of gentlemanliness was something that had to be proven primarily against the manhood and the status of other men. In other words, the main threat to a man's masculinity and status and manhood over the centuries is usually presupposed to come from other men's masculinity, and is, you remedy if you feel deficient in manhood, you go to the gym or you take fencing lessons or Charles Atlas courses and you read books like this one. But today the difference is that the threat to masculinity doesn't come from other men primarily, it comes from the culture, including the political culture. And it's a little different. In some ways, the book, I didn't want to redefine a gentleman. I didn't want to come up with all my own ideas, but I did find that the ideal had to be reformulated, restated mm-hmm. in ways that men today can hear. And I really was struck by how many of the ideals, the traditional ideals, are still valid, but they don't necessarily, they need to be stated in new ways.
Yes, yes. And the question that kept coming up to my mind is, what exactly do you think has happened to manhood and masculinity? And we could, I as a woman, I often have to ask myself, what has become of the idea of womanhood and femininity? Who am I? Who am I supposed to be? And so part of what we're dealing with here is the general change in the relation between the sexes. Give us your take on that, Steve, and how it affects your work here.
Well, it's a big part of the book. The whole the last quarter of the book or so is on relations between men and women. But even from the beginning, there is this idea that that we do live in a culture today which, in many ways, is hostile to masculinity and to
yes.
men. And so many men are afraid to even if you feel deficient in your manhood, many men are afraid to acquire more because they're afraid of they're acquiring toxic masculinity.
Right.
And they'll be punished for it. So it requires a certain amount of finesse to be a man, to be a gentleman, and not run into the barrier of political correctness. I think the main threat to masculinity, to answer your question, what has changed the most directly, of course, is the ideology of radical sexual ideology that has that is hostile to masculinity or wants to redefine it or eliminate it altogether. Not entirely. There's other things too. There's impersonal forces. Most men are not manual laborers anymore.
Right.
Most men do jobs, for example, and have status that women can do just as well, oftentimes, even if they don't want to. There are certain economic changes, impersonal forces that have changed our society. But overwhelmingly, what is hostile to men is this ideological, and so I don't shirk that. I, as I've taken it on in previous books, And I take it on in this one. I think a man has to grasp the nettle. You can't be afraid to be a man.
Yes.
You're afraid to be a gentleman. You've got to do it without apology. But there's certain things, the difference between just manhood and being a gentleman has always been a matter of, acquiring a certain finesse, or a certain, matter of social graces and so forth, which allow you to be a man without making other people feel defensive or insecure.
Yes,
or
yes. Serious. And when you talk about ruling, the man's role is to rule something. This is the thing that I think drives people crazy. Okay, so this is how masculinity becomes, by definition, toxic, because nobody has the right to rule anybody else. That's our conceit. This is me now. Everybody listen up. This is not Dr. Baskerville. This is Dr. Morse now talking. Our modern conceit about ourselves is that we're egalitarian and that nobody rules anybody else. But in point of fact, that's not true. We have hierarchies all over the place. The difference now is that the guys at the top of the pecking order are not accountable to anybody. You know, the way in a feudal system or the gentry system that you're talking about from earlier times and so on, there were understood to be obligations attached to you ruling your little plot of land, whatever it was. You didn't just, it wasn't licensed to do whatever you want. It wasn't licensed for patriarchy or toxic masculinity. It was something else. But this is the sticking point, I think, where men do need some guidance and women do need some guidance about how to navigate that. So talk to us a little bit about just the role of egalitarianism and how that complicates the role of the man here.
Well, it does. I mean, we do live in an egalitarian society in many ways, and we have for centuries. And you know, when the ideal was imported into America from England and other colonial countries, Canada, Australia, it became more egalitarian. It became removed from the class system to a large extent. So there is an element of this, and it became democratized. And the ideal became something that you could aspire to actually a little more easily. You didn't have to work your way up into the, you didn't have to attend Henley Regatta and you didn't have to attend Royal Ascot. You could take the essence of what it meant to be a gentleman, and any man could aspire to this, even those quite low in the pecking order. There's no contradiction between egalitarianism as such and the ideal of a gentleman. Where there does come to be a conflict is when egalitarianism is forced upon people with certain, ideological convictions about attempting to abolish all distinctions of status and so forth. But the gentleman is not necessarily nowadays attached irrevocably to a particular social class.
I think the relations between men and women have become so politicized and so have become a vehicle for importing other kinds of ideologies and forms of social control into society. Tell people a little bit about the relations between men and women and how they've changed over time and what you think a gentleman should be in relation to a lady.
Right. Well, I do discuss that quite a lot in the book. Of course, the traditional notions of what we'll call gallantry rather than chivalry, because chivalry actually historically has a lot of meanings beyond the relations between men and women. But of course, the traditional gallantry that men are expected to show toward women, I endorse almost all of that and talk about the more important bits as I see it. In the book, I talk quite a lot about courtship, marriage, and the way that courtship especially has given way to new forms of relationships between men and women, first dating, then hooking up, then, legal warfare in the courts. But the idea of rejecting marriage and family and children and female companionship to actually adopt this as a permanent lifestyle is to reject something basic about manhood and basic about your humanity. We have a natural instinct attraction to the opposite sex. We have a natural instinct to reproduce. Men have a natural desire to see their name and their lineage continue. Marriage does more than just give you female companionship. It connects you. It makes you a stakeholder in the society.
Yes.
And in ways,
yes,
it makes you a stakeholder of what comes even after you're gone.
Absolutely.
And it connects you with what has come before you, mm-hmm. the past and the future. So to reject this is to admit defeat, and that's not manly. It's not a gentleman does not admit defeat without engaging the enemy.
Right.
Yeah, and that's what it is. So even though it's horrible what men go through in the divorce courts, and the idea of losing your children, and the fact that the only way to really to protect yourself is to not have children, not marry, and have children in the first place.
Right.
But that doesn't work. I mean, that's basically turning your back on not only a happy life, a fulfilling life, but you're turning your back on your own civilization and the future of your civilization. And that's, if men do that, then they're not men anymore. They're not fully men.
And you know, this was one of the most moving things to me about your book, Steve, was the number of times you said something like that, where you said, you know, yes, I get it that this stinks, fellas, but suck it up, buttercup. You know, you got to get a grip. Being a man means you don't run from the field just because the odds are against you. You stay there in the field and you fight because it's worth doing. If you need a tactical retreat, okay, I get that. But that's not the point. Retreating is not the point. The point is to come back and fight another day. And that is deeply connected with what it means to be a man. And I would just say, as a woman, and by the way, just for the record, I've been a woman my whole life. I didn't just discover this 5 minutes ago that I'm secretly a woman. No, as a woman, that's what I'm looking for in a guy, not only in my personal life, but also somebody to collaborate with, somebody to work with. I'm not looking for a guy who's whining and complaining and running at the first sign of trouble. You know, I mean, women are in fact drawn to these men that part of the culture is labeled toxic, you know, and that's what makes everything so confusing for men and women alike, I think. So anyway, thank you for saying that part of it, Steve. I mean, I think that's really helpful.
Men really have more leverage than they think.
Yes.
When it comes to women, when it comes to society. And I try to make them aware of that leverage in the book. For example, you know, I point out that, you know, a gentleman, of course, has rules about dress and grooming and comportment and so forth. But I also point out just briefly that women have these rules too. And if a woman wants to go out with you, be seen with you in public, looking like a prostitute, too many men go along with that, and just, you know, they think it's some kind of, you know, great, it's sexy, or it's, you know, a trophy or something. But that's not a woman who wants to go out with a man. If she isn't appropriately dressed, she's insulting you. She's insulting you, and she's insulting everyone around her. And you have the right, and in fact, you have the duty, I think, to say no. This is the corollary. People scold men for looking at other women, allowing their eyes to wander. But the corollary to that is women who dress in ways that present themselves in public in ways that are inappropriate and insulting to the people they are accompanying. Right. And a man, you know, if you're going to, you know, men, I'm sure many men don't even think of this. I didn't think of it for a long time until I was writing the book. And I thought, no, a man should say, no, I won't do it. You may dress as you like, but if you want to be seen with me in public, you will present yourself in a proper way. And, you know, I think once men do that, I think other women, older women and other women would be very glad to join them.
Yep.
For that. You know, I'm thinking of Mrs. De Gaulle, you know, who, back in the 60s, who had a campaign against women who dressed indecently. And so it's, you know, these things have to be reintroduced. Some of these ideals, these values. Mm-hmm. And, it's a natural role, I think, for older men and older women to do it, but all men, I think, have to do it to some extent.
I've gotten a little bossy in my old age. I've noticed, you know, that I'm a little more willing to come forward with advice, and I feel like, okay, I'm going to play the old lady card here. I don't really care. If you don't like it, I don't really care. And I think the word rule, let me suggest another way of putting what you're saying and see if you think this is right. When you say a man is supposed to rule his turf, however you might define that, another way of putting that is that you have a responsibility, you know, that you are supposed to take responsibility for a certain corner of the world. Right. And there's a manly way to do that. We could say, I could say that women have certain responsibilities to their turf, the world around them as well, but rule doesn't quite capture it. But the thing that's common to the man's role and the woman's role is that we both have complementary and necessary responsibilities, and we can mess it up. I mean, if we just say, well, I'm going to do whatever I feel like it because of radical individualism or whatever, that doesn't really cut it either for a man or for a woman, I think. But I don't know. Do you buy that word? Does responsibility, does that concept bias anything here?
No, absolutely. I think that's right. And I think I would add, just, you know, we have been messing it up. I mean, you know, you and I are part of the generation that messed it up pretty badly. And those maybe a little older than us, and starting really in the 50s, but especially right. in the 60s and 70s, you know, our generation really, you know, we rebelled. Our parents should have cracked down more.
right.
It's easy to say now. But yes, we did not accept, you know, we didn't accept that responsibility. The only problem, you know, a lot of conservatives today sort of blame men
yes.
for this, and they, you know, it's very easy to scold and to say that men are juvenile and adolescent in their behavior, and there is a grain of truth in that, but there's two sides to it, both of which feed each other, and both of which complement each other in a diabolical and a negative way. The, you know, the injustices to men and the failure of men to rise up and, you know, their tendency to accept those injustices rather than rebel against them in a constructive way.
Right.
This is another theme of the book I kind of end on, is that I argue that a man, and this is connected again with the task of ruling, I argue that men, that rebellion is antithetical to being a gentleman and to being a mature man. That rebellion is part of the life cycle. That rebellion, in some ways, is, you know, it's something we go through in adolescence. We, you know, the person to rebel with naturally is your father, who teaches you ideally how to rebel in a constructive way and how to channel that rebellion into, you know, into constructive criticism of the world and not mindless rebellion. But of course, a lot of men today don't have fathers.
Right.
Or if they do, their fathers didn't. They didn't have fathers. The teaching of this lesson broke down over the years, and so that natural rebellion that should, you know, work itself out in adolescence and be corrected by the, you know, the father figure, it continues on through life, and so you get men in their, you know, 60s and 70s still listening to rock music and still. Using jargon and taking on, you know, taking on the feminist jargon, complaining that the world is sexist against them and that they're second class citizens, and, you know, these kind of cliches left over from the civil rights movement or left over from borrowed from feminism, and so they become the mirror image of the feminists that they detest so much. So my argument is that when you stop rebelling and accept, even though you have a lot to rebel about,
right,
there's a lot of
right.
injustice in the world. And your rebellion may be justified, but it's still, you know, rebellion, self-pity, these, no matter how bad it is, this is never justified in a mature man.
Yeah, self-pity is deadly for anyone, I think. And so self-pity has now become kind of the ruling genre almost of how people conduct themselves. And there's a difference between rebelling and taking responsibility for correcting some corner of the world. And one thing you find out is that if you're actually trying to get something done, it's not easy to get something done. And it's much easier to sit around and complain generically and across the board, because you never then have to do anything. You know, it's too much. But once you say, okay, there's a problem in my neighborhood, and I'm going to that school board meeting, and I'm not going to back down, no matter what it costs me. Well, as soon as you do that, now all those other complaints have to go away, because they'll be in the way of you doing that one thing that you said you were going to do. And so it requires some discipline all the way around, whereas rebellion is just kind of undisciplined rage or something. Is that consistent with what you're saying, Steve?
Absolutely, absolutely. For example, one place I point this out, especially toxic, if I may, is in popular music. And I point out that in popular music today, which again, many men, I think, listen to far too long into life, the two things that emerge in popular music are two things that emerge at about the same stage in life. One of them is sexual awakening, and the second one is rebelliousness. They both tend to emerge around in adolescence. Mm-hmm. And the music, if you look at, you know, many of the videos today, even videos that may have a message that I agree with sometimes, but, you know, they're still they're full of sexual images, and
right.
they're full of angry rebellious lyrics that again can be nihilistic, and this feeds upon these two emotions, sexual
yes.
You know, sexual aware sexual freedom, sexual rebellion, and rebelliousness taken together, especially as expressed in music, is are both toxic for a man.
Yes.
For an adolescent man, very destructive.
I mean, yes.
I know, and some others know, you know, at the age of adolescence.
You know, one thing I noticed in your book is that corresponding to the gentleman is also the lady. And in your chapter on relations between the sexes and marriage and courtship and all of those kind of things, you talk about the mutual relationship between being a lady and being a gentleman. And it seems to me the potential there is for the positive spiral instead of this negative, you know, race to the bottom kind of thing that we're involved in so often. Talk about that positive spiral between the gentleman and his lady and how they support one another in becoming the best, the higher version of themselves.
Right. That's a good question, because of course I don't take it upon myself to discuss, you know, the definition of a lady in detail. I do so mostly so that a man can know how, you know, can know how to spot one.
And, right.
You know,
right.
Actually,
if you would start with that, how do you spot a lady? Okay. All you guys, all you crazy, rebellious guys, men going your own way. If any of y'all are watching this, listen up. Steve, how do you spot a lady?
Well, good question. What are some of the things I discuss? I mean, one is, you know, a woman of convictions, including religious convictions. And I distinguish between convictions and beliefs on the one hand and opinions on another. Convictions are, of course, things we should all hold quietly, perhaps, but, you know, you know, rigorously when they are challenged. And a woman may be quiet about her religious or other convictions or her beliefs, but when she is challenged, including by a man, she will stick to them. And this is different than a woman who has car covered bumper stickers and momentary opinions that can be changed without any notice. So this is one thing I argue for you know, a woman who wants to be courted rather than a woman who wants to be empowered, a woman who's, you know, overly concerned with her equality and rights, who wants to politicize your personal relationship. I mean, these are things to be avoided. I argue that, you know, men and women should avoid subjects like, for example, discussing things like politics and religion with people that you don't know well. Even though these are important topics and among my favorite, there are things about, you know, there are matters about which you should have principles and convictions and beliefs, but not necessarily momentary opinions on. You know, a woman who's overly opinionated is a red flag that you should watch out for. Frankly, I do say very strongly that a woman who is a single mother already owes you, if you are having a serious relationship with a woman who's a single mother, she at the very least owes you a serious explanation as to why she is a single mother.
Right.
I mean, it's one thing, she might have been abandoned through no fault of her own by a man. It does happen. It's also used as an excuse by many women who have actually done the abandoning.
Right.
If she's done it to another man, she will do it to you. So
right.
You need to be, I'm not saying all single women, all single mothers are guilty. But at the very least, you better get a pretty firm explanation before you enter a lifelong relationship with a single mother. So, you know, these are the kind of things that I consider the most important. I'm sure there are others, and other people can add other things to the book.
Yes. You know. Yes. And I think one of the things that's the most countercultural about your book, Steve, is that you take for granted that men and women are different. And in our world today, where we started from the premise that the differences between men and women are insubstantial and don't matter, and now we're to the point where you can change whether you're a man or a woman because that whole thing is so insubstantial, you know, that it's possible to do that. You're starting from the premise, and not even defending it, you're just starting from the premise that men and women are different, and that's the foundation of everything that you talk about. And so what I would say to readers is, when you're reading this and you come along this, a lot of what Steve's going to say is going to really ring true in your heart. And if it does, you got to ask yourself, maybe that whole thing of men and women being interchangeable, or the sex of the body being somehow unimportant that we can dispense with, maybe that's wrong, you know. Maybe that's not really working for us.
No, very true. In fact, it's more than just wrong. It's actually quite dangerous.
Yes,
the androgynous society is more than just wrong. It's quite dangerous, because it goes back to what you were saying earlier about responsibility. The myth of androgyny, What it does is it allows both men and women to take on the privileges specific to each sex and to renounce the responsibilities that are specific to either. So by declaring yourself androgynous or interchangeable or transgender, you get to have all of the advantages, all the good things, the privileges that both men get and all the privileges that women get, but you don't have to take on the unpleasant responsibilities that either one has. So obviously, no society can function that way.
Well, that's a really powerful thing that you just said. And the poster child for that would be the mediocre male athlete who decides to call himself a girl so he can win the girls' track meets. He's taking the privilege of being a woman, you know, he's taking his privileged body and placing it into a place where he can succeed, but he doesn't have any of the responsibilities or problems or anything else that a girl of that age would face. And he can't by definition, you know. Now, you know, and another thing that I don't know if you and I have ever actually had this conversation, but I think it's implied in a lot of what's going on in your book. And that is that, in my opinion, there has been a concerted effort to get men out of the family, to marginalize men from the family. It's not just that men are abandoning the family, it's that men are being pushed out. And in my opinion, and I suspect yours too, but I want to get your take on this, the way I would put it is that getting the men out of the family was a major strategic coup for the sexual revolutionaries and for power mongers generally. You know, if you can remove the natural head of the family and then replace it with a state or a bureaucracy or some other kind of functionary, you can accumulate a lot of power because the woman and children are now sitting ducks in a certain way. And the resistance, the possible resistance to the centralizing force that's been removed from the family. That's my opinion, Steve. And, you know, I don't know, your publishers might not like me interjecting this into this conversation, but I'd like to see, you know, what do you think about that? Do you think it's been deliberate?
Oh, very much so. And even if it wasn't deliberate, it's kind of the natural course of events as the result of this. And in fact, there's a good book to be written still about that. I mean, there was a 19th century a French anthropologist who pointed this out, that the father is the weakest link in the family. The bond with the father and between the father and the family is the weakest.
Yes.
The mother and the children have a natural biological link, but the link with the father has to be socially constructed because so that link is the easiest one to break, and that's what we've broken first with the welfare system and then with the divorce courts. And once that's broken, of course, then the other bond, then the mother can, you know, they can come in and remove the mother as well. This happens a lot. I spoke to a conference once and I told the mothers, I said, look, you can't go around using the social workers to engineer the removal of your child's father and then complain when those social workers come in and engineer your removal from the children afterwards, because that's what happens. Once the father's taken out, then the mother is often taken out,
right?
And so the whole family disintegrates, and the, you know, the functionaries of the state become the de facto parents. So yes, the father is the weakest bond, and once he's removed, everything else is much easier to destroy. So no, you're absolutely right about that, and there's a good book to be written on that.
And do you think, you know, the people who are redefining masculinity as toxic and redefining femininity as erotic and sexually available, the people who are doing that, what is their end game? Do you have any sense of that? What are they after? Why are they doing this?
Well, there is a sense. I mean, yes, I think, I mean, I don't talk about this in the book. Maybe this will be the next book so much. There's a little of it. I mean, there is a sense in which, you know, the man is naturally the more powerful individual, of course. And, you know, for the woman, this presents a paradox. If she adopts a competitive attitude, if men and women are in competition, then, you know, the man wins initially, but the woman gets the ally of the state to come in and to remove him. So this is why I argue that, you know, men and women can never compete with each other in a stable society. So if the woman adopts a competitive attitude, then she's going to envy the man's power, and she's going to want to destroy the man and get his power. If on the other hand, the woman takes an attitude that, you know, the way to get the power of the man is to marry him and to be protected and provided for by him and to form a unit, a family unit which in turn serves as a counterweight, as a barrier, as a bastion against the power of the state, then the man and the woman together have more power than, you know, either one of them alone, and they have a domain that they rule, and they have children, of course, and they are the only ones in a society, the only people that are allowed to exercise coercive control over another human being are parents over their own children. So the family becomes what the Puritans called a little commonwealth, so it is all the way through this. I see it, you know, maybe it's because I taught politics for 30 years, but I see it as a lust for power, and oftentimes a dysfunctional understanding of how power has to be distributed in private life. And you know, if men and women marry, then the woman gets the benefits of the man's power. And she can, you know, she becomes the ruler of the domain, of course, the family as well. So that's how I analyze it. If I was asked how, you know, as you asked me, what is their end game? I think that's overwhelming. I mean, we hear about equality, but I don't think it's equality. I think it's a lust for power. And libido, all the way through it, it politicizes, you know, the relations between men and women.
Yeah, libido dominandi in St. Augustine's memorable phrase, the lust for power. And in our time, literally, you know, lust has become part of the power base and the way that it's used. Now, that brings me to another question that I'd like to explore with you. And that's the whole question of sexual abuse, sexual exploitation, accusations that men have raped or assaulted women. You talk from time to time in your book about men being falsely accused, which is, you know, obviously a problem. We at the Ruth Institute have been deeply involved in dealing with clergy sex abuse, which we feel most of the time the accusations are founded, they're true. But the problem is people then turn around and say, well, you can't prove it. We can't prosecute this guy because we don't have any evidence, and so on and so forth. The nature of the problem, Now I'm looking at it from our perspective of the person who actually has been abused, a child who's been abused by a person in authority, a clergyman or something like that. You can't prove the case because by the nature of the thing, it's private. It's taking place in secret, you know, and gathering the evidence and all of that. Well, that's also what makes it ripe for the false accusation. It's like there's two sides of the same coin. I wonder if there is a way that your analysis of proper behavior generally provides some kind of way forward through this morass. I don't know. I don't know. Have you given any thought to these parallel problems? It's like you and I are both talking about the same problem, but you're emphasizing one side. I'm emphasizing the other side. It is the same problem somehow. I don't know. What do you think about that, Steve?
Yeah, obviously, the sexual revolution, as you say, has unleashed, you know, behavior in some people that is, you know, that is hideous, and that is also beyond the, you know, the realm of the reach of state adjudication and prosecution. I mean, the easy answer to your question is, well, if you have evidence and you prosecute somebody, you give them due process of law, and you see if the evidence, you know, warrants their conviction. Otherwise, you leave them alone. Okay. Having said that, it's a little bit too easy because, as you say, there's a whole realm of behavior that is beyond the reach of the state. And this is a good example of how, I think the best I can do is to say that it's a good example of how the non-political, the non-legal norms of a society, religious comportment, family pressure, you know, social pressure, family discipline, things like that, are absolutely essential to human existence, to moral existence. Once you remove those things, once you remove the norms of correct behavior and the norms on other people to pressure one another into correct behavior, then you have nothing left but the state. And then the state becomes either horribly authoritarian, which it does in the case of false accusations against fathers in divorce courts, domestic violence, for example, horribly authoritarian, or the state becomes ineffectual and cannot prosecute real examples of molestation, because they are beyond, because they're hidden and beyond its reach. So, you know, when we leave this vacuum, when we abandon our religious and moral beliefs and traditional institutions, we leave this vacuum that is filled up by the state. I do think one practical way to deal with this is I would like to see people, ordinary people, people like you and me, conservative people, if you like, avoid the feminist and the radical left jargon.
Mm-hmm.
Because when you dignify concepts like sexual harassment, or you dignify concepts like domestic violence, this jargon, which can be used to mean anything, sex abuse, domestic abuse. I mean, these are some of the different terms that are used. You know, insulting someone or yelling or calling someone fat is a form of violence.
Right.
Or, I mean, what we used to call pedophiles or sexual molestation or, pederasty. I mean, I would avoid this concept, like this prepackaged jargon that the radicals have come up with, like, sex abuse, sexual assault, especially domestic violence has an awful lot of baggage around it. So the more you can avoid these kind of terms, the more you can avoid dignifying these kind of terms, the more you will be dealing with the real problem, the substance of what took place, rather than some radicals' spin on the matter for political purpose.
So what would be the right terminology?
It's difficult.
Right.
It's difficult to repossess, to regain language that means something, language of integrity. But I guess what I object to is when I hear conservatives, for example, accusing Bill Clinton of sexual harassment. That's perhaps the most flagrant example. Bill Clinton was unfaithful to his wife, and he was hitting on a married woman. Okay, now
yes.
I would call that, to me, that's adultery. To me, that's fornication. To me, that's
right.
There's a good traditional language for these things. Sexual harassment can mean anything.
See, okay. And this is where your book comes in, because your book is talking about good manners. Your book is talking about how a gentleman conducts himself. Okay. So we have all these images going back decades of Joe Biden handling people and people going, he's creepy, creepy Joe Biden images, right? He's creepy. That's sexual assault. That's sexual harassment. Shouldn't be touching people. The fact is that putting a creepy guy putting his hand on my shoulder is not the same as rape. It's not. Okay, people, it's not. But it is not the behavior of a gentleman. It is not the way you behave. And so, in a sense, what you and I are saying in our, kind of different perspectives, good manners and the taboos do a lot of work in society. They're not legally enforceable. But if everybody in society is going like, what is wrong with you? That's a real that adds up to a real tax, right?
Yeah.
But if the person who gives you the stink eye, if that's the bad guy, and you get to keep on being creepy Joe, you've lost something of value. I guess that's what I'm trying to say. How would you analyze that, Steve?
I do talk about that a bit. There's a section sexual harassment, and I argue that a lot of what's called sexual harassment is. I concede, of course, as I've argued elsewhere, that a lot of what we call sexual harassment is just boorish behavior.
Right.
It would steal, if we just observe, some of the traditional rules, and maybe a little even more rigidly than traditionally they were observed, we would steal a lot. We'd pull the rug out from under the radicals and
right.
steal their thunder. And, a lot of it is unnecessary. Now, a lot of it, for example, I mean, if you look at, construction sites, men whistling at women, I mean, some of this is working class behavior and the women go along with it. This is just the,
right.
kind of the culture of some sections of, for example, working class. The more a man aspires to status of a gentleman, the more, it's probably a good idea to put some of those things behind you. And it's just not necessary.
Right.
So, I think we could do that a lot. There was one part of the book, they made me take it out, publishers, don't blame them, where I said that, nowadays, even a man who, if you see a woman struggling with a baggage or something on a train, some people are now arguing that, the best thing to do is to just leave her in peace.
Let her struggle.
Let her struggle unless she signs a notarized permission for you to touch her belongings. This might be a little extreme, but it kind of shows the kind of things that, we do have leverage. We do have things that we could be doing that could be effective in working these things out, short of, litigation.
And
charges.
And the literal long arm of the law. And what has happened when you remove the taboos, when you remove the social graces and the sort of informal code, as you say, all you're left with is the formal code, which really can't do it. The formal law, it can't reach into all the nooks and crannies of people's behaviors. And so when the feminists told us the personal was political, what we didn't realize is that what they were really saying is we intend to politicize every aspect of your personal life. That's what we intend by that. And they never said that, but that's how it's turned out.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Even the historian Eugene Genovese, who was a former Marxist himself, he said that was a totalitarian slogan.
Yes.
Very much.
I may have gotten it from Gene now that you say that. I used to know him. So, you know, in a sense, what we're saying is good manners and the code of the gentleman can succeed in ways that the state or politics may not be able to succeed. Do you think that's right?
Oh yeah, very definitely. And they give every man, every individual, an agenda, if you like, an action item, put it that way. It's something you can do something about, is your own behavior. And there's ways, if we do this, if all men observe these things, it won't solve all of our problems overnight, but it will give people the habits of mind and the approaches to these things that I think is more constructive than, becoming the mirror image of the feminists, then constantly resorting to litigation or state action or politics. There's a place for politics. There's a place for asserting your individual your rights, your constitutional rights.
Right.
It's all good, but it doesn't have to be the first resort. There's a lot we can do. We have a lot of room to maneuver that we don't realize, and if we recapture that, it's a good first step.
So, Steve, who should read this book? This is for men, but what kind of men? Who should read this book?
Well, any kind of men. I think especially young men. As I say, it's an old genre. It goes back to the Renaissance, the Middle Ages. The books were traditionally written for young men by older men like me. They were written for example, during times of great social movements when you had a lot of peasants coming to the cities, working their way up through the social ranks. They had to be taught how to be citizens. They had to be taught how to be, urbane and polite and even rulers. And so, this still happens today. People coming up, working their way up through the social ranks, making a lot of money, but not feeling accepted by the class that they want to be part of. So it's really for anybody who feels like, I was going to say they're insecure, but we're all insecure. Who isn't insecure?
Right. Right.
We all, being a gentleman is a lifelong endeavor. It's not something you're, very few of us are born to it. Even those who go to Eton and Harrow and then Oxford and Cambridge or Harvard and Yale, nowadays, haven't a clue about these things.
That's right.
So we're really having to recapture the things that we used to be taught, by our fathers, by our schoolmasters, by our priests and pastors, because they've all broken down. They've all abdicated. Right. We've all abdicated in many ways, mm-hmm. our responsibility. Mm-hmm. We have to relearn it in many ways. There's a big section on education in the book because a lot of it has to be simply relearned. A lot of us, we're victims of progressive education.
Progressive in air quotes. Progressive in air quotes. They're not progressive. They're regressive.
Exactly. And we can't just whine about that.
That's right.
Blame. We make sure we don't pass that on. We pass something on better than what we were taught in the schools of the 60s and 70s.
So. And it strikes me that another group of people that could particularly benefit from this book would be young men who don't have fathers, who don't have father figures, and who, because now that is one of the biggest class divides that we have, is were your parents married for a lifetime or were they not? That's much more important than whether they owned their own farm or, whether they have a title of nobility or something like that. Were your parents married and did they stay married? And so, gentlemen, young men, if you don't have a father in your life, I think you will find this book of some benefit. And those who are watching, if you have a young man in your life, who is struggling in some respects because he doesn't have a father or father figure, I think this would be a very appropriate gift for you to consider. You should read it yourself, I would say, before you hand it to a young person. But I think a lot of you will find that young guys who could benefit from what Dr. Baskerville is saying. Steve, what's the easiest way to get this book?
to send you to the Sophia Institute Press website, which you can get it there. You can also get it on my personal website, www.stephenbaskerville.com with a PH.
Stephen with a PH. Stephen with a PH. Baskerville.com, where you'll get a lot of other interesting stuff too.
Right, exactly. Yeah, if you want some more heavy duty books, you can find them there. But I'm glad you mentioned that about fatherless youth, because to some extent it was written with some consciousness with an eye toward that group, because of course
yes.
That problem is very, very serious today.
Well, Dr. Baskerville, I hope that a lot of people will watch this interview and be blessed by it. I think anybody who watches it will be blessed by it. I hope Sophia Institute Press has a great success with your book. I hope they use this interview to make the book a great success. And I hope that a lot of people from this book are introduced to the other line of work that you have, dealing with divorce, no-fault divorce, the politics of it, and so on, some of which is housed at the Ruth Institute, among other places. So, Steve Baskerville, thank you so much for being my guest today.
Thank you. It's my pleasure.